All right, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, we'll ask that you turn to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 15, and we're going to begin reading in verse 11. Luke 15, beginning in verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. I'd like to preach, the Lord being my helper this morning, on the thought, what brought him back?
Amen.
Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and watch care. Lord, we thank you for your all that you do for us, that the Lord, that we would be preserved. Lord, we pray for each that are before us this morning, that you would give them an open heart. Lord, that you would brighten the scriptures unto them, and it be real, and it would burn within their hearts. Lord, we pray for the lost, Lord, and we pray for the redeemed, Lord. We ask that you bless, according to your mercy and grace, we pray it. Amen.
Amen.
Now, we're reading very familiar verses of Scripture this morning, and I've heard this preached many, many ways over my years, but there's a great deal of truth in here, and a lot of people teach or preach this as a parable. But I want you to see the Bible says, and he said, a certain man. Now, when you do deal with specifics or certainality, you're dealing with real things. This is not a parable. This actually happened. I don't know the names, and I don't know the who, but every time that the Bible says, and he spake unto them a parable, you can know that it's a parable, and when he does it, you have to take it as a literal, real thing. I've also heard it taught that these two sons were two type of men. But I don't believe that either, because we'll find that really they're the same type of individual. They're redeemed folks doing what redeemed folks do. And a lot of people will teach this younger son as a lost person, and I do not believe that. Verse 12, the Bible says, and the younger of them said to his father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me, and he divided unto them his living. Now, this is a very brazen son, and we live in a day of very brazen, upright, disrespectful people. And if you don't believe that, you try teaching a nursing class to people in their 20s and 30s, and you'll find that there's a generation been risen up that doesn't respect anyone. They don't respect authority, they don't respect parents, they don't respect teachers, they respect nothing. And we certainly do that. And I was talking to a young girl one time, and she says, you have to earn my respect. No, that's not true. And the thing of it is, you should respect the position. If you don't know them personally, it's like the president of our United States. Whatever you felt like what happened in November, he is our president, and you do him respect. That is what respect of position is about. Now, this young man disregarded his father's position. Now, I'll say this. If you're in a situation where you say, Daddy, I want what is, when you die, I want what's coming to me when you die right now. Number one, you disrespect his office. And number two, you have no concern of life. Because he said, I'm not waiting till you die. And you know what? We live in a generation today where nobody respects life. And if you don't believe that, you ought to see how the elderly are treated in nursing homes. And you ought to see, listen, when Roe v. Wade hit in 1973, what a debauchery has happened in our country since then. I studied recently on that, and it may be getting a tiny better. You see some of these abortion clinics closing down now, but still, even today, 3,325 babies die every day in the United States as an abortion. That is every day that occurs. And so we see type of disrespect for his father. In other words, he didn't care whether he lived or died. That was his attitude toward his father. Now, I want you to see, on the surface, this doesn't look like parenting. Doesn't look like good parenting, but he was a very wise man. And the Bible says he divided into him all his living. In other everything that was of value, he divided and said, okay, this one's yours. But I will say this, it didn't say that he gave it to the good son. And I personally think he kept the portion that belonged to the good son for himself for a while. But what would be due the younger son, he gave it. Now listen to me, young people, that shows me this, and I know from my own life, you can make very stupid choices as a young person. You're not ready for life, you know. And we kind of push people out the door at 18. And I don't know where we came up with that, because I didn't hardly have sense enough to come in out of the rain when I was 18. But we say that's an adult in these days, and that's how they're treated. You know what? You know what the Bible calls an adult? Most people don't know this. 40 years old. And I would have to agree with that. That's when I began to get a little sense. And so we see then that we as the people of the Lord today often act like this young man did. But that was very good parenting. Verse 13, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. Now let me say this. First of all, he got all the money together and he headed out. And things always look better on the other side. They always look better. A very far country. I don't know where he went. Now, I personally believe, again, this is a real parable, a real story. And so I think that he must have left Jerusalem and went somewhere. Maybe to Egypt. Maybe to the kingdom of Nebuchadnezzar. I don't know. But he went somewhere that looked good. He went somewhere that he felt like had more to offer him than little podunk Jerusalem. He wanted something better. You know what? That is a fleshly aspiration. Is always continually wanting more and more and more. And what we end up doing many times is giving our life and seeking things that are very, very temporal. And that is what this young man kind of had on his mind and decided to do, was leave what was normal and go somewhere else. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together. Now, I want you to interject this. It must have been a small enough amount that he could carry it with him. Did you ever think about that? I don't know how much he took out and how much of it was in cash money or jewels or gold or exactly what it was. But really, you would have to say if he gathered it up all together, he didn't get much. You know, this flesh is never satisfied.
Right.
If you don't believe that, look at the obesity we have in our nation today. Yep. That is the very base of it, right? We are not a satisfied people. People that will go into debt. I heard this the other day. A man that I kind of work with, he teaches another department, paid $60,000 for a truck. You know what? That's exactly what Don and I paid for our house, and I'm not making that up. That's exactly what we paid for our house. You know what that is? That's the satisfying of the flesh. And you know what's even doubly surprising to me? He went in debt for it. Now, I don't know about y'all, but what little piece of car we have, and we financed it, I guess the payments are, what, $400-something a month? I don't know. So somewhere in that neighborhood, could you imagine what a $60,000 vehicle would cost? And I guess we paid about $25 for that one. I don't know. But could you imagine the payment he has monthly on a $60,000 vehicle? And I'll say this, don't go, whoo, I'd never do that. Yes, you would. You most certainly would if you got in a position where you thought you could do it. And so we see then that was the nature of this young man. He wanted what he could get. Now, it says he went to a far country and there wasted his substance. Now, if you underline in that Bible of yours and you mark it, you look at substance real carefully, because yes, he wasted his money, but it went deeper. You know what? Your substance that you're made of is your testimony. My daughter-in-law said the other day, and I really didn't realize, she said, everybody in Dover, Tennessee knows you. And I didn't ask her what they said about me. Just because they know you don't mean it's good. But that's my substance, whether it be good or bad, right? Not my money, not the little place on Tobacco Port Road. My substance is who I am. And he wasted it all. You know, it's a bad thing to spend everything that you got and you don't even have a place to sleep or eat. But it's quite another thing to destroy your testimony overnight. And you can. And so we see that this man's substance, everything that he had, was completely gone. Now again, I believe that they're speaking in specifics, and so I have to believe that he was Jewish, and he was no longer identifiable as a Jew. He no longer carried himself like a Jew. He no longer presented like a Jew. No longer wore the garments that a Jewish person wear. He was totally, everything was gone. His substance wasn't there. Now, how did he waste it? Riotous living. Partying and party. That's how he wasted. You know what? That's how you'll waste yours too. You listen to me, young people. You hear what I say. You'll waste your substance and who you are. You go in that direction and you'll wish you did. Right. It may take you 10 or 15 years to wish you didn't, but you'll wish you did. That's riotous living. That's living in the flesh. And so we see then that this young man was geared that way, and he was glad to do it, and his substance was gone. Verse 14, and when he spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land. Now, famines come and go. You find the Great Depression of the 1930s in the United States. That was a famine. Those of you that remember the early 70s, they called that a depression. Now, they didn't want to use that word back then because they didn't want the American people to panic. But if you study history now, they called the early 70s a second depression. Those things come and go, and that's what happened. But listen, you hear me good. There's a spiritual famine in our land.
That's right.
Now, I'm thrilled to death that we have a first lady that started a speech with the Lord's Prayer. If you haven't seen that, four congressmen got up and walked out. See, we live in a spiritual famine. Again, I'm thrilled to death with what I've seen so far out of President Trump. But don't get to the idea that the famine is over. Look around. There's people that preach truth. And, you know, I'm thrilled with the crowd. This is packed out for us. Those of you that are new to us, man, I haven't seen this in a long time. But I want you to see, compared to other groups in Dover, Tennessee, how many do we have? Go up to First Baptist. You know, they have two buildings now, two services. They have one in the Christian Life Center and one in their main auditorium. They're so packed. But you know what? I don't believe that they would tell you there's nothing you can do to save any of yourself but the goodness of God. Do you?
Never.
I don't think they would. They would say, you say this little prayer and all will be well. The only problem with that, it's not in the Bible. You'll never find that in the Word of God. You won't find them saying there's a way to dress like a woman and there's a way to dress like a man. You won't hear them say that. Right? And so we see, don't judge success by the numbers. And we still live in a spiritual famine, even today. And when he spent all, there was a mighty famine in the land. and he began to be in want. Now, I want you to see this is somewhat driven by his physical needs, but we'll see that he eventually realized what he wanted was to be back at Daddy's house. What he wanted was to be back in a land where that was ruled of God's things. And that's why I say this young man was sad. Because he wanted better things. Now, if he was lost, he would have been just as fine as anything down in the hog lot. We will find also that it says that he fain would have starved, but nobody would give him to eat. Now, you think about where he was at. He was at the hog lot, and the corn husks were there, and he didn't eat them. And you know why he didn't eat them? They weren't his. That's an honest man, isn't it? That's a man that ought to be looked after and respected. That's why I say that this young man was saved. Verse 15, and he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him unto the fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, now that's another thing to me that you can measure spirituality about. If you come to yourself, does it drive you to God or does it drive you away from God? Does that make sense? What does your own advice give you? What does your own advice drive you toward? Now if you're redeemed and you're living in a manner near unto God, it will drive you to God. The Bible says, draw nigh unto me, and I will draw nigh unto you. And so, a redeemed person is driven by self toward God, and a lost person is driven completely away from God. You know what? I believe some of us just need to hit rock bottom. I really believe that. That's what happened to this gentleman here. He finally hit rock bottom and he got to the end of himself and that end of self-satisfying glory. And then he began to think like a spirit man again. Verse 17, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. Another reason I believe he was redeemed, he says, the first thing, my first problem is this, is I have sinned against heaven. See, that's a spiritual problem. Well, what he did with his father is wrong, but that's a fleshly problem. My relationship with my father was fleshly. The relationship I have with my mother, and I love her dearly, it's still fleshly. It's not a spiritual relationship.
Yeah, right.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
And so his concern first was that he would go to God, and that's a spiritual fault. That doesn't come from man. That and so he said, I will go and I will confess this thing. I will confess my sin. I will rise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I sinned against heaven first, and before thee second, and am no worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he rose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful type of confession of sin and making things right. Man. You know what? You don't see that anymore. You really don't. You think about how many times you've seen someone come brokenhearted before the Lord. I would dare say that almost nothing in the last 10 years. That's an average church. I think we saw a little something a couple weeks ago. I think it made the devil mad. But I think we saw a little something. We need that. Just a little wind. Just a little tiny cloud. Remember when Elijah prayed? He prayed seven times.
Finally, the servant came back and said, I see one little cloud about the size of a man's hand. He says, let's get down to the house of God. See, he knew that little one little hand cloud was big enough. He knew God had answered his prayer and that he was fixing to do something. And behind that, by the time they got to the palace, listen, it was on them. It was fixing to come, and dark clouds was everywhere. He trusted in God. And so this young man confesses. His plan was to confess sin, and his father rewarded him greatly. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let's eat and be merry. Now, I want to notice a couple of things on this, and we'll go somewhere else. First of all, those things he gave them were not just gifts. They were identifiers. The robes were familial, meaning that each family, each tribe had their own set, and it made them look like being of the tribe of Asher. It made them look like they were a piece of the tribe of Reuben. And I don't know what tribe this young man was, but it identified him as family. It identified him as a son. And then he put that ring on his finger. And that showed him that he was his father's son. He restored him. You know what? I feel like a lot of times, the reason our churches are so cool, so cold, is we need to be restored.
Amen.
Right. We need to be back. You think about the joy that filled your soul the day the Lord saved you, and you compare yourself to now, and where are you at as an individual? Verse 24. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. We won't get into the reaction of the other sons this morning. Go with me to the book of Acts. Now here we find a flip side. And I'm afraid today in the modern day believers, we have more of these than we have true sons. We read of a man named Simon who was a fake. We read of a man named Simon, and if you know the story, the Bible says that presented himself as some great one. That's the first indicator. That was the first description. There was a man of Simon that named Simon that presented himself as some great one. You know what? We have a lot of so-called preachers today that present themselves as some great one. That they're just arrived, and I'm not putting anybody down. But you know what? You can look. You know what? If the Lord Jesus Christ could have 3.5 years of personal ministry and end up with 12, I'm not too impressed with somebody that has 10 or 15,000. Are you? I'm not. In fact, and I'm not judging, I believe they go after the way of Baal, according to the Word of God. You know what mega churches do? They sell you on entertainment. They have their little latte shops out in front of the church. They have their good-feeling music. You know what? It sounds like the same trash I listened to in the 80s. It really does.
Yeah.
And all it does is tickle the flesh. All it does is make you enjoy the things of this world. And are they successful? Well, yeah, in man's eyes, they're successful. And they're growing leaps and leaps and bounds. But that doesn't mean they have the presence of God. And so we find here that Simon was that type of person. He presented himself as some great one that was successful. Now, I want you to see that... The Bible also says they use sorcery. He was some great one. And listen, if you've got yourself foolish enough into believing that you don't think witchcraft is real, you better think real hard again. You know one of the most hellish moments in our nation's history is when the Beatles came to America and began to stoop our young people. If you don't believe that, follow why they chose the beetle as who they were. And I can give you some reference. It starts in Egypt. That's where it starts. And you know what? It just grew and grew and grew on that base into the filth that we have today. And so we see then that's the kind of person it was. It was just sorcery. It was just witchcraft. It was just convincing other people that he was something that he's not. And if we're willing to listen to that trash, listen, that is what we become. It's sorcery. Same thing with the TV and the filth that we can put on that if we do. Be very choosy in what you let your parent, your children listen to. And so that was Simon's nature. There became a revival in that place. We find that Philip was preaching. You know what we need? We need brave men to go down to the middle of nowhere on a street corner and preach the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's what Philip did, wasn't it? And I know it's embarrassing because I've done it. When you first step out of that truck and get everything set up, you're looking around, okay, I'm going to look like an idiot, but here we go. But you know what? According to the New Testament, that's what God always blessed, was it not? That is evangelism. That is listen, you know what? Sinner people aren't just going to drag into the house of God. We've got to take the gospel with them. And it's always been that way. We somehow got that fouled up in the New Testament age, but that is never how it's been. So we find Philip preaching. Verse 12. But when they believed, meaning all this city, all this area, but when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also. Now, I want you to see two things. First of all, that God honored Philip's preaching. And I don't know where the Lord saved you, but I hope it involved preaching. Because the Bible says, through the foolishness of preaching. In fact, it says, some shall be saved. Not all, but some. Some shall be saved.
Right.
And so we find here that Philip gets out and he's obedient to God and he's following out the Great Commission. And he preached, and it said that some believed and some were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. But I want you to see that the Bible says simply of Philip, and Philip believed also. Watch people that have no follow through. It never says that Philip was baptized. Watch people that have no follow through. If they don't come to church, I don't have much confidence in them. Because the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is, and so much more as you see the day approaching. You know what? The day is approaching. Jesus Christ is very near and is stepping out on the clouds of glory and saying, it's enough. Come up here. So I'm going to go more. I'm gonna look for places where I might preach the gospel and that I might attend churches and that I might hear more and more as the days draw nigh to the Lord's coming. And so we see that Philip really wasn't that much involved. When Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized, I apologize about my mistake. He continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and the signs which were done. Now, let me say, it is good to be in a gospel meeting. It is good to see the Word of God preached. It is wonderful to see sinners repent. It is a great thing to see people saved. But don't think you can do it on your own. See, he had no understanding at Philip's miracles. because he thought Philip was doing them. You know who was doing them? The mighty God of all heaven. He was doing it through Philip, but Philip wasn't doing them. But we find this disconnected and, I believe, lost person pretending that didn't understand. You know what I have found with lost people in the church? They just don't understand spiritual things.
Right.
You can be rejoicing over preaching and they're sitting there.
Yeah.
I don't have much confidence in them. Do they have to act like me? No. But I'll tell you what, I'm thrilled with the preaching of the Word of God.
Amen.
It thrills my soul. And you know what? I just can't keep it within. I've got to rejoice. That's what a man is all about. I agree. You're right. That's what preaching is. That's what hearing others preach is about. And so we find that he follows along, but he's more interested in the signs and the wonders than he is what God is doing for them spiritually. Verse 14. Now when the apostles were at Jerusalem, heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm not sure I understand all of that, but we have to know this, that the Holy Ghost had not come because the Bible said they had not yet received the Holy Ghost. So whatever that means, it means what it says and says what it means. At that point, they hadn't received the Holy Ghost. And we find the apostles come down and they prayed for them. You know what a dried up, next to nothing church needs? Somebody come over and pray for them.
Right.
Man. That's the truth.
Yeah.
Listen, I love revivals. But what churches need today is prayer. I love preaching. But you know what? They need prayer. You know, been more than once, I've walked around the perimeter of this room just praying for every one of you. And I'm not saying that braggingly, but it gets the job done.
Yes.
And so we see that Simon really didn't understand any of these things. The Holy Ghost came down, and those individuals received the Holy Ghost. Verse 16, it says, for as yet it was fallen on none of them, only they that were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands that the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money. Now, I want you to see this gets back to the shell of who Simon was. What was he doing before any of these events happened? He had them people duped. He was getting their money. He had himself, the Bible says, presented as some great one, like the Billy Hens and all that. And now we find he shows himself and said, oh man, you think of the money I could have with that? He offered him money.
Yeah.
But see what it did. It showed who he really was. See, you can go on a little while, but it'll show you who you are. You think about the little families that have come and gone here at New Testament. You know what? I pray for them, but I don't get the boo-hoos, because all I think is it showed who they were.
Amen.
You say, well, you're judging. No. I'm going by the Word of God. What does the Bible say concerning new believers? By their fruits ye will know them. If they're God haters, if they do not honor the Word of God, if they disrespect others, if they disrespect their parents, I have no confidence they've been born again. And so we see then, we see that this man was just that way. He went along for a little while, and he followed it out for a little while, but it did not last. And he got back to the root of the man who he was, and he says, I want some money. Verse 19, saying, give me also this power, that on whosoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Now, what's a gift all about? We don't know. I will say in the New Testament era. Now, the church was very kind to me on my birthday. Bought me a couple of new suits, or Donna bought me one, and the church bought me one. I didn't anticipate it, except from Donna. I didn't anticipate a suit. But it was my birthday. So is that truly a gift? Not really. I was anticipating it. People who celebrate the Christ Mass, are those exchange of gifts really a gift? You expect it. So how could it possibly be a gift? Right? Now, I've told this story before. I'm going to have to start using something else. But when I found out my sister wasn't going to make it, I went and got Donna 2 dozen roses. Because I wanted to know, I got it now. Because she's alive and I'm alive. She was totally blown away. You know why? It wasn't our anniversary. It wasn't her birthday. It wasn't my birthday. And I don't remember. I know it's at the end of May. That's all I know. That's a gift. Totally, and everything surprised. So this gift of the Holy Ghost, he got it convinced he could give him a little bit of this right here and get it himself. You know what? That's not a gift. That's not a gift because, man, he's anticipating. He exchanged a few greenbacks, and really, what is that? That's a purchase, is it not? And so we see that he did not understand spiritual things at all. So verse 21, the Bible says, "Thou is neither part nor lot in this matter." Now, a part is a position, a lot is an ownership, like we own a little lot of land. "For thy heart is not right in the sight of God." So I want you to notice two things. He had no ownership in the kingdom of God. That shows me that he was lost. And he had very warped sense of spiritual things. You think that the power of God can be bought with money? And so we see that Peter's very forthright. He says, "Listen, you have no evidence, you have no indication whatsoever that the Lord has even saved you." Notice what else he says. "Repent therefore of this thy wickedness and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in a gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity." Again, I think he's lost. I think he's a fake. He didn't come back to God the ruler, the inheritor. But he, in fact, he says, "I think you're in the gall of bitterness. I perceive it." You know how I perceive things as a registered nurse? I taught my students this all the time. I look, listen, and feel. That's the base of your assessment. You can smell too, and I have, but that one's a little rougher. And Peter along the way watched him get me. "I perceive you're in a gall of bitterness." You know what? If somebody has to grab you to the house of God, I perceive that you're in a gall of bitterness. A gall of bitterness. If when you get here, you sit here, and you'd like to be anywhere else but the house of God, I perceive you in the gall of bitterness. And so we find that, Peter wasn't easily duped. And he says, "Listen, I've watched you. I see what you're about." Now also, again, I think he's a lost man. He says, "You are in a bond of iniquity." A bond is a chain. You're tied up. You have no place to go. Isn't it a wonderful, blessed thing today the Lord saved your soul and set you free? That bond of iniquity rolled away. Iniquity is another word for sin. And you are no longer a servant of it. You are no longer guilty of the death that comes with the law. But you are free and you are happy for the very first time in your life. See, Simon had no symptoms of that at all. You often wonder, and I don't like to go out too deep and imagine, but I wonder if Peter ever said, John, did you see how Simon was acting and preaching to him today? Something like that.
And so we see then that we as the Lord's people, there, the Bible says their fruits meet for salvation. They ought to be seen. Notice verse 24, and Simon and then answered Simon and said, pray ye to the Lord for me, that none of these things which thou hast spoken come upon me. Now, my last thing that I think that Simon was pathetic. He says, you pray for me. He either knew one or two things. He was in such a situation spiritually that he couldn't pray himself, or he was lost. You know why I reject the sinner's prayer entirely? It's because God don't hear lost people. You say, oh, that's wrong. Well, this is the truth of the matter. You're made born again, you're made alive, and then you pray. Doesn't work in the other direction. In fact, it's an impossibility.
Right. Amen.
So I guess what I'm saying, are you a Simon? Are you like that son? Son indeed. A son that received his just inheritance. But he got so far out in this world, he was no longer even identifiable as the Father's Son. I know it. I've been there. But I just praise God. And when I was involved with that thing, and the very stillness when my party buddies had done all went to sleep, that I felt like Elijah when he was hid up there in that cave from Jezebel. And he said, what doest thou here, Elijah? What are you doing here? How did you arrive at this spot? Repentance is a wonderful thing. You know, it follows always salvation, and it follows getting right with the Lord. We need that today. This church needs it. Every church up and down these streets needs it. Every church across the whole world, they need that. We need repentance.